Some people may protest that exploring the psychological differences between Easterners and Westerners unnecessarily draws attention to our differences rather than highlighting our similarities. On the flip side, however, most disagreements are caused by making assumptions about the ways different people process information. And in an attempt to better communicate, better cooperate, and better cohabitate, I do believe this is a worthwhile exploration, and I hope you do as well. The contents here are influenced primarily by the book Geography of Thought by Richard Nisbett and several studies he and his team carried out. Richard Nisbett is a professor of social psychology at the University of Michigan at Ann Arbor. He was born in 1941, making him more than 80 years old, and he is heavily decorated in academia. I'm only mentioning these things so that you understand that this is not some fringe psychologist we're talking about. Richard Nisbett and these ideas are a part of established psychology, and Richard sends his best wishes. In one experiment, developmental psychologist Liang Huang Chu showed American and Chinese children photos of a cow, a chicken, and grass, and asked whether the children would pair the cow with the grass or with the chicken. So, which would you pair with the cow? The chicken or the grass? As it turns out, Nisbett and his team found that most Easterners paired together the cow and the grass, while most Westerners paired together the cow and the chicken. Now, why would that be? In another experiment, Nisbett and his partners Li Junji and Ji Yongzhang compared U.S. students with Taiwanese students by presenting them with three words, panda, monkey, and banana, and asked them to indicate which two of the three were most closely related. Nisbett's team found that Westerners tend to focus on taxonomy, that is, categorizations, and for this reason, they tend to pair together the cow and the chicken, and the panda, and the monkey, because they are animals. Easterners, on the other hand, tend to focus on relationships, and for this reason, they're more likely to pair together the cow and the grass, because the cow eats the grass. They also found that Western children tend to learn nouns faster than verbs, while Asian children tend to learn verbs faster than nouns. In another study conducted by developmental psychologist Anne Fernald and Hiromi Murakawa in 1993, researchers went to the homes of mothers with infants 6, 12, and 19 months old. They presented a stuffed dog and pig and a car and a truck. They asked the mothers to play with the toys with their babies as they normally would, and as it turned out, American mothers used twice as many object labels as Japanese mothers, words like picky or doggy, whereas Japanese mothers engaged in twice as many social routines of teaching politeness norms, things like empathy and greetings, for example. An American mother's patter might go something like this. That's a car. See that car? You like it. It's got nice wheels. Whereas a Japanese mother might say, here, it's a vroom vroom, give it to me. Good, now give this to me. Yes, thank you very much. In this way, American children are learning that the world is mostly a place of objects, whereas Japanese children are learning that the world is mostly of relationships. Nisbett writes, strange as it may seem to Westerners, Asians don't seem to regard object naming as part of the job description for a parent. American children are learning that the world is mostly a place of objects. Japanese children, that the world is mostly a place about relationships. Okay, another experiment. What do you see? One of Richard Nisbett's Japanese students, Taka Masuda, hypothesized that Asians typically view the world from a wide-angle lens, and Westerners often have tunnel vision. He tested this by showing a series of colored underwater scenes to Japanese and American students. All scenes had at least one focal fish who was larger, brighter, and faster moving than anything else in the scene. Each scene also contained some less rapidly moving animals, as well as plants, rocks, bubbles, etc. When asked about what they had seen, Masuda found that both Eastern and Western students reported about an equal number of references to the focal fish, but Japanese students made 60% more references to background elements, including the water, rocks, bubbles, and inert plants and animals. Japanese students also made twice as many references to relationships involving inert background objects, referring to the brother fish or the uncle fish. And perhaps most interestingly, the first sentence of the Japanese students were usually in reference to the environment. For instance, it looked like a pond. Whereas the first sentence of American students were three times as likely to refer to the focal fish. Okay, another experiment. We start this time with a wooden cylinder, and we label this wooden cylinder a dax. Which one of these two images would you also label dax? The wooden triangle or the metal cylinder? Cognitive sociologists Mutsumi Ame and Deidre Gentner found that on average, across many trials with different objects, more than two-thirds of Americans called the metal cylinder a dax, whereas more than two-thirds of Japanese people called the wooden triangle a dax. It's tempting to infer here that Eastern students care more about the substance, whereas Western students cared more about the form. Anthropologists characterize the thinking style of the East as Eastern dialecticism compared to Western formal logic. Dialecticism is any form of reasoning that finds harmony when presented with two contradictory arguments. If you're familiar with the work of Hegel in Western dialecticism, there's a focus on finding a synthesis between two contradictory arguments. But in Eastern dialecticism, there is no synthesis. Rather, there's merely an acceptance of two simultaneously contradictory truths. And there are four basic tenets of Eastern dialecticism. First, the Tao. In Eastern dialecticism, the goal is knowing the way, which is roughly the translation of the Tao, in order to find harmony with the environment and with the community. Second, change. Reality is a process of change, and what is currently true will soon be false. Third, contradiction. Because change is constant, contradiction is also constant. It's okay that things are one way today and will be different tomorrow. And lastly, relationship. The whole is more than the sum of its parts. Parts are meaningful only in relation to the whole. In the words of Richard Nisbet, change produces contradiction, and contradiction causes change. Constant change and contradiction imply that it is meaningless to discuss the individual part without considering its relationships with other parts and prior states. Now, let us compare this Eastern dialecticism with Western formal logic. Well, in Western formal logic, the goal is not to live harmoniously with nature, or with community. It's knowing and discovering the capital T truth. As compared to Eastern dialecticism, which embraces contradiction, Western formal logic relies on non-contradiction. A and not A can't both be the case simultaneously. Nothing can be and not be at the same time. Well, as compared to Eastern dialecticism, which embraces change, Western formal logic embraces identity. A equals A. Whatever is, is. A is itself and not some other thing. And there's middle exclusion. That is, everything must either be A or not A. Nothing in Western formal logic can be partially A. Of course, these are simplifications. but they are intended to highlight the differences between the two thinking styles. Do we find counterexamples? Of course we do. There are absolutely Easterners practicing more Western formal logic and Westerners practicing more Eastern dialecticism. These are gross generalizations, but sometimes these generalizations can be useful. And of course, this is all muddied by an increase in globalization in the last 50 years. If we were to run these same experiments on Westerners living in Asia or with tight connections to Easterners or to Easterners living in the West, it's very likely that we would find different results than those found by Richard Nisbet and his team. More Westerners are picking up an Eastern worldview, and more Easterners these days are picking up more of a Western worldview. But what we're analyzing here, though, is the traditional culture and the norms that resonate today that influence the ways that many people around the world interpret and process information in order to help us better communicate